Okay, so we have this taped down. We have one layer of trace. I'm going to label that first overlay. And first thing I want to identify is where the horizon line is. So we want to think about placement relative to door heights and the first floor. Here's a little hint. Here's a door height right here. So the horizon line is going to be running through approximately, if the SketchUp model is correct, and the SketchUp model has been struck from the standard camera angle of a person, you can look at approximately the two-thirds point of a door, and the horizon line will probably be there. You double-check that against where the vanishing points are. You can trace the vanishing points of awnings and of the architecture to a vanishing point. The vanishing point will also be on that horizon line. This is just for your reference, but as you can see, the awnings and parts of the architecture do indicate where the horizon line is and where the vanishing points are. So go ahead and lay those in so you remember where they are and you have them as a reference point. When we start to place people and trees and other objects like umbrellas and cafe tables, you will want to know where the horizon line is for sure. Just go ahead and lay that in. And of course, that's the perfect time for my pencil to unlay. Perfect, just perfect. Brilliant. So I always have a couple of spares here in my pencil extender. The only true reliable way to sharpen a Prismacolor pencil is to whittle it, because it just exposes enough of the lead and it doesn't cause crushing or vibrating of the lead that causes it to crack. Next, we can start customizing the middle ground. So this is a very basic notion of a corner store. It could be a cafe, deli, bodega, something of that nature. It might have office or it might have housing above. We've got a little bit of a walkout here. We've got some pretty tall windows here. This is a point here where if you want to start to add more decoration or more ornament to the building, you can start to do that. Add another cornice line, if that's interesting to you. If not, add more of a, either add just a very subtle line. And you'll notice that I use my parallel glider pointing to the left vanishing point as I reinforce the lines that are already there. This is where you can really take this drawing and make it your own. Start thinking about corner elements. In urban design, we talk about the triumphal corner, where we take the opportunity to take architecture and ornament and mark the corner building, use the corner buildings as a way of allowing folks to know where they are in the community, being able to identify corner buildings in the landscape, be able to tell one corner building from another one, and be able to tell them apart. I might even start to think about how this outdoor terrace or deck could be divided between two apartments. If we wanted to think about two apartments above this store or this deli. We can even start thinking about signage. Or start thinking about multiple doors. These are all things that we can start to do on this first overlay. Maybe this is a door. Maybe this has some fancy signage or something. It's something you can do on this layer. Practice your lettering. Practice your script. Maybe it starts to become a freestanding neon sign or something like that against that awning. That could be block lettering, that could be script lettering. But this could be a freestanding deli neon sign, if that's allowed, according to your design guidelines. Or it could be an iron sign backlit one of those. That's noticeable, but that if it's set on structure in and with the awning or against the awning, you can modify this awning if you want. Maybe too long for you. You can modify it, get it to where you want it. Start thinking about some of those elements. Really just customize this building the way you want it to be. The curve here, so you need to make a double line with that. And we've got a sidewalk vanishing to the right vanishing point. So we'll knock that in. We wanted to think about some cafe seating. Again, just draw the box it came in. Cafe umbrella is going to be taller than eye level. It has to be taller than eye level, otherwise we would hit our face every time we walked up to the table. So draw the cube that the cafe table and seating came in. And that gives you the opportunity for a foreshortened circle, some seats, some people socially distancing, sitting outside, drinking lattes. And then a center point goes up from the middle of that, and you can terminate that into a pyramid or an octagon. Pyramid's pretty easy because two lines of that pyramid will vanish. All four lines of that pyramid will vanish to the vanishing points. This one will vanish to the right. This one will vanish to the left. This will vanish to the left. This will vanish to the right. Simple pyramid on a stick. On a stick! But it has to be taller than eye level. Otherwise, if we walked near it, we would hit our face on the umbrella. So this might be another person walking up, or it might be waitstaff. They should be eye level with the horizon line, or just below. Or if they're a basketball player, they'd be just above it. These are called teeth people or tooth people. Looks like an extracted tooth. You ever had your wisdom teeth out? They have a little tiny little dot for a head. Remember that the proportion of the width of the head to the shoulders is a 1-to-3 relationship. The head is 1/3 the width of the shoulders. So no big space domes or ants. Tiny, tiny little head on top of the extracted tooth. That's all you need for a drawing of this scale, from this distance. Closer a person is to the viewer, their head is still very much at the horizon line, like so. But let's say that they're walking across the street like this, coming towards you or away from you. Pyramid on a stick. Simple umbrella for a cafe table. You can also do it as an octagon. In Indiana, if your deli serves alcohol, it has to have a 3-foot fence around it. That is excise law. Okay? If it doesn't serve alcohol, it does not need the fence. However, if you want to protect toddlers from darting into the street, it's good to have a fence, right? That fence will keep toddlers from darting. So that may be an important thing to think about. So that fence might come up to about 3 feet, which is 2/3 below horizon line. That fence could just knock in right there. You Kentucky law, no rules whatsoever. They serve alcohol right on the street. No problem. You'll notice that. When you go to Cincinnati, you cross the river to Newport, Covington, you'll notice that all the serving laws are different in terms of how alcohol is contained in outdoor seating. These are good things to know because as we continue to design for distancing, all these different rules still have to be in effect so that restaurants are complying with the law. Start making some decisions about windows now. Adding window mullions. Mullions are the structural divisions between each pane of glass. Window frames. This building is facing south on the site, so I may consider additional awnings dropped in for additional shading and additional color. Residential probably wants a little more privacy. Their walkout terrace will provide some of that. A dividing wall between the two decks adds to that privacy so that we're not able to see directly into the apartments at night. That would be bad. Think about another car over here. Just start by sketching in the box that it came in. That's an SUV. Decisions we have to make about whether or not we include SketchUp cars into the SketchUp model, or if we bring them into Photoshop, or if we draw them by hand. These are all things you want to adjust in your workflow. So if you're not sure about a car, just bring in one into your SketchUp model, print it out, and you'll have it there ready to trace it. Bollards. Bollards are so important because there is this phenomenon now of cars just crashing into storefronts. It's happened at least once a week somewhere. Someone crashes into someone's storefront. So bollards are a way of dividing or capturing traffic before they barrel into our seating area or into our storefront itself. There's a great Twitter account called the World Bollard Association that has just examples of great bollards from around the world. It's intended to be a satirical account. Might then start to bring in some grasses or flowers, shrubbery, grasses. Remember that bushes are a political dynasty. Shrubbery is the proper term for these ornamentals. A student tells me that they want to put bushes in their project. I ask them if they want to put any Clintons in it. Bushes, Clintons. You want to decide how much of this storefront is all window, a good portion of it. There might be what we call a kick plate. Kick plate is steel or aluminum from the ground floor to a smaller level. Up north in Michigan, we don't put glass all the way to the ground anymore because ice and snow will inevitably blow up against it. So we raise the kick plate on a storefront to accommodate for all that ice and snow. Ice and snow accumulating against a window will cause it to fail because it will melt, refreeze, cause the window to fail. So we call this the kick plate. Some folks call it the ice plate. It's just the portion of the storefront that will be of a certain color or aluminum or steel, not glass. Architecture in the background. It's going to become less definite, right? Less specific. It's going to get more general as it's kind of fading into the back. So maybe this railing, a couple of windows, and that's it. And then we can start to very generally bring in these row homes. We could simplify them significantly. We could add additional windows as well. But because they're so foreshortened and because they're disappearing from us, we can be less specific and less definite. Just start thinking about railings, awnings, that's about it, because there's not much that we're going to be able to see as they vanish away from us. Same goes for this commercial building in the back. I'm going to be less specific about it. I'm going to really generalize and simplify it because it's going to be disappearing into the background. Just two lines emerging from this island, very close together, into this pear-shaped or columnar or circular halo. And then I just break it up into thirds. The first third is the trunk. The second third are primary branches. The third third are tertiary branches. They then divide. That first zone, that trunk divides into three or even four veins. Think about how blood flows from your arm and into your fingers. It's the same principle. It's the same circulatory system principle. That nutrition and that water and those minerals come from the trunk and they start to divide. And then they divide again into that second zone, into the secondary branches. And then they divide again into the tertiary branches. There's some lower branches as well. It's very, it almost looks very cellular, right? Almost like a kidney, or very much like how blood divides into your fingers from the central artery into the capillaries. Same principle. Do this for at least the tree that's visible here. It's less noticeable in the background because the next tree will be just past the car and it will be very much covered up. We'll practice it over here as well. The first third is the trunk itself. The second third are the primary branches. The third third is the tertiary branches. Primary, secondary, tertiary. Up and then divide. Up and divide. Divide into the canopy. One third. Sparkies, you remember this? Probably one early morning last spring. If I'm not sure of something, there's an old trick, you just cover it up with a tree. Or cover it up with grasses. There also is a tree line in the background because of the suburban property where we're at. There's going to be a tree line in the very back. That's going to be your bed. And we know this from our computer exercises. There's a visible tree line that creates the boundary for the whole property. So that'll be part of the drawing as well. I need a framing element on the left. Where we have this person and the crosswalk are really good for framing elements on the right, but I need something on the left. And so we're already kind of, this is our bioswale here to the left. So this might become a foreground tree. So it might be the side of a tree like this with a branch and leaves starting to frame out the left part of the drawing. A person is standing there next to us, maybe they're leaning on the tree. Their eye level will be very close to ours, so they might be right there. Maybe they're looking at their phone, waiting for an Uber, taking a picture. Just something to anchor that left-hand side of the drawing. Thank you. I'll kind of point it with my non-dominant hand. This gives me a blending finger, so that as I add a layer of marker, I can blend it very quickly using my non-dominant hand. I'll take sky blue. Using my two fingers, I will turn it, open it by turning these two opposite. If you have any trouble at all unseating the marker, if you twist them in two opposite directions, it should pop just fine. To reseat the marker, just drop it onto the table. Don't pile drive it, just drop it. The force of the marker itself dropping onto the head will reseat the cap. But this is sky blue, aptly named. The cloud is a negative space, so look outside. The cloud is negative space. We are painting the sky, not the cloud. The cloud will be the remainder. Okay? Put that in your mind. The cloud is negative space. So as I add some blue, the white that's left over is the actual cloud. As I add the blue, the white is the cloud itself. Don't be afraid about going into the tree. We'll blend that all together with green shortly. It's okay to go into the trees. We're going to make the trees very transparent. As you can see, looking outside the horizon, you've got some cloud cover. That becomes thicker as you get to the horizon line, so I just make that mostly blue at the horizon. Then I blend with my non-dominant finger. Remember, the cloud is what's left over, the negative space. The cloud is the negative space. You're not drawing a cloud. You're painting the blue of the sky and leaving the cloud as the negative space. The cloud is the negative space. Do not worry about the tree. Just paint right over it. We will blend green right over her shortly. Take the blue all the way to the building line. And to the tree line. Not to the horizon line, but take it to the tree line or the building line. Remember, the white is the cloud. Sky blue can be layered on top of each other. You can get a couple of layers going. So you can increase the intensity of the color with two layers. Three doesn't work as well, but you can get two layers on there. You can see that the color is a little bit more intense there. I'm going to reseat the marker by just dropping it onto the cap. Upper story windows will reflect the sky. Upper story windows will reflect the sky. So you can paint a little bit of sky blue on your upper story windows only. Upper story windows only. Lower story windows will reflect the context. Cars, people, trees, other buildings. But the upper story windows will reflect the sky. Okay, take your cool gray 3 and your cool gray 6. The 3 and the 6, we're going to start building up some depth. Lower story windows are going to reflect the context, not the sky. So we've got some things in shadow. We know this from our base image here. We've got some deep shadow happening underneath our awnings and stuff. So we'll paint that in. reference image here. And then I take that 6 gray, or even a 7 gray, and block in that heavy, heavy gray as the shadows from my awnings, as well as the reflections of the context on the lower story windows. Upper story windows reflect the sky, lower story windows reflect the context. People, trees, cars, other buildings. Some depth in here. Cars maybe quickly get a little bit of darkness in them, underneath them. This building in the background just gets a little bit of gray, that's all it needs. Shade under the awning or the umbrellas. Reference image tells you about the different levels of grays that you can continue with. My 3 gray, there's going to be a lot of shade. A lot of shade thrown around by this building here, I'll tell you what. A lot of shade being thrown around. Don't know what I think about that. We're all civilized here in Yorktown. You Muncie people come over here. That starts to get some depth going before we add any additional color. Now, where the sun hits the tops of the trees, we get some golden yellow up there. Look at the trees. You'll see the tops of the trees receive the sun. You see a little kiss of yellow, particularly now in early autumn or mid-autumn, wherever we are. Trees are peak where I grew up right now. We're near peak here, but the autumn blaze maples are already changing. And you'll see that the yellow will mix with the sky blue and start to produce some green already. So just a kiss of sun, kiss of yellow, the tops of the trees, and it'll already start to mix with the sky blue that you've laid down. At this point, you can decide if you want to do an autumnal rendering or a summer rendering, right? At this point, you can decide. You can keep going for autumn, or you can go back into spring and summer. At this point, you make that decision. After you lay in the sky, lay in your shadows, and lay in your yellow. Now, do you want to go autumn or do you want to go regular summer?
Autumn.
Autumn? Okay. So I will pick goldenrod next. As I'm working, I'm rotating the barrel of the marker. Rotating the barrel, rotating the barrel. As I do that, I get different marks. Different types of pointillism. I do a few and then I blend them. Okay? I'm rotating the marker as I'm contacting it. Gives it me different types of leaf stroke. Starts to give the impression of leaf material, of leaf texture. Again, look at the trees outside. You can see through them, right? They're fairly transparent things. So I put in a layer of leaves as I'm rotating this, and then I blend it with my non-dominant hand. Lay that in directly over all these other branches. It will displace the sky blue and even blend with it. You can see that difference. See that difference? That's why we weren't worried about the sky going through these trees at all. We're going to render them very translucent. Very transparent.
And
acne, so that's goldenrod. Just a little bit of pointillism. I'll use the toe of the marker, just a little bit of extra pointillism. You'll just work with that sky blue and displace it a little bit, blend with it. Tap the marker, reseat the cap. Next, I think I will use chrome orange or desert tan. Either one will work. Either chrome orange or desert tan. I'll lay that in below the goldenrod. That looks like a maple. There we go. I think we've got it. That looks like a maple. Lay that in below that yellow. That's October, my friends. That's October. World Series baseball. First third of the NFL season. That's October. College football Saturdays. Except in the map. Looks like Big Ten has a plan to come back. That's exciting. Maybe the trees haven't changed entirely, just a little bit of green. This could be an apple green, grass green, or palm green, or an olive green. Just a little bit of green left. Just a little bit of green left. So they're not completely changed. You can see our trees outside are still changing, so there's still a little bit of green left. But lay that in below the desert tan and below that goldenrod, and then I will hit my shrubbery is some of this green. This is a palm green. You can use grass green or apple green or light olive. I'll use a little bit of that desert tan for the grasses here as well. Get those grasses in there because the grasses are probably going to be dormant by October. Get ready to cut them in October so that they regenerate in the spring. I'm going to take that palm green and I'm just going to knock in a layer for that tree line in the background. Then, I think I'll take my desert tan and I'll just start to lay in some color on the buildings. This could be a combination of desert tan. It's a good brick color for this area. And I will alternate that with buff or beige, because that's a good limestone color. Either buff, light sand, or beige is a good limestone color. This is light sand. Building to be a little darker. Here's a redwood. Or this is burnt sienna. I want to go for a really dark, dark Tuscan red. I can alternate that against the light sand. Just get a good Italian red going there. Just really accent it against the other things. How about an awning color? What kind of awning color would you like?
Green.
Green? Dark green? Lime green?
So a good old Starbucks green right there. Create some contrast against the light sand and against the burnt sienna. I'll use that color on the doors as well. It's a good old Starbucks green right there. Just makes you think about coffee all of a sudden. I'll use that for the awnings. I'll use that for the umbrellas. I'll put a little bit of it into my shrubbery. Add a little more green. I'll pick a cold blue maybe for some of the other awnings, other signage, or other doors. Just the door is noticeable. Red and orange are also good colors for those. I have an ultra hot pink. For the neon here, a little bit of lavender. Okay, this is a pink versus green color complement. Maybe this is just early evening and the neon has just been turned on and it's casting onto some of the other surfaces. Get a little bit of black and just hit where the dark shadows are, just for some extra depth. Creates a real contrast there between the awning and the facade itself. Just a little bit of shadow at the top of the window frame. Awnings, terraces all cast dark shadow onto the facades. Dark shadow underneath the car. Maybe a light shadow being cast from the person and from the trees. Some light shadow underneath the trees. Light shadow in the cafe area. Light shadow people onto the buildings. Now take our friend Blueberry. Blueberry now. We're going to add Blueberry to our trees and plants. Blueberry is the color complement of anything that contains yellow. Automatically makes it look darker. See that difference? This is the shaded part of the tree. It's casting shadows onto the ground. Plants are casting shadows onto each other. And because blueberry, this purple, is the color complement of everything that contains yellow, It provides us with a little bit of extra darkness in the plant categories. It's an old watercolor technique. Mixing purple in with greens and browns creates areas, instant areas of darkness, while still being fairly transparent. I also put a little bit of blueberry on one side of my person, a little bit of blueberry on one side of this person. Makes them look round as opposed to flat. And I'll take my pale cherry or a peach, and I'll do the other side of the person. We'll get the deli sign there. This peach is nice. I can add it to the trees. So peach and pale cherry are very versatile colors. I can add them to the grasses. I can add them to the building. Spots. Variations of color. Just make this start to look like a village. Our foreground tree needs some leaves, so I will spin the barrel and just drop in leaves. Each marker hit is a leaf. Each marker hit is a leaf. Foreground. Leaves like to be close to branches. I think I'll take blueberry and finish out the foreground tree like so. Then I'll just grab a handful of colored pencils and accent, blend, join, bring together any big areas of color that I think need emphasis for texture. The background trees maybe need a little bit of texture. The foreground grasses need a little bit of extra blending. Our folks need a little bit of clothing. What that does is it blends right over the blueberry and that pale cherry, makes them look round so that our folks don't look flat. They could be wearing blue jeans, khakis, whatever. You blend the color over that, see how it makes the knees, the legs and the knees look round. You can layer that color directly over them. Want that car to have a color? You can leave it gray and it'll just be a silver car or a white car. Or you can layer in color. Just a little bit of color to give that car painted finish. You don't want your eye to go straight to it. You want your eye to go to your middle ground. You can navigate folks around, move people around by just having a little bit of extra color. Represented by clothing, represented by cars, awnings, furniture, a little bit of splashes of color that just continue to move the eye around.
working in communities, I often find out what the school colors are for the high school. I'll add banners and lighting, celebrating that particular local school. Folks always like that. Or I'll have people wearing the team colors. Those little details sometimes just help capture the imagination of the audience. So I finish with the colored pencils, I flip it back over, and then I, where these indicate I will use the old cursive S method. It's just a series of cursive S's that give the impression of leaf. You can also use a cursive G. It's an old draftsperson's trick for leaf cover. Was a letter S. In cursive. That's it. Yes, believe it or not, it's just a cursive S. But you can draw the impression of leaf cover quickly. Old draftsperson's trick. Need a little more gray, just a little bit more gray, so I'll take my Cool Gray 3 and just reinforce this edge. And blend it into the paper. Just reinforce this edge. Blend it into the paper. That's it. No dark asphalt. Light gray. This 3 gray is enough. Put that into the paper. Sign it, put your signature in a place that can't be easily cropped away. Hide it, nest it into a corner. That way they can't crop it away. There is so much a tendency to eliminate the artist's name from things. So if you nest it into a corner here against the horizon line, they can't eliminate. Most press agencies will put artwork provided. Well, you want your name in there, okay? Unless you don't want your name on the project, but then it's a secret project or something. Sometimes those happen, but make it so that it makes it difficult to eliminate your name from the artwork. But there are some situations where you don't want your name associated with it whatsoever. There are cases where the project may have a non-disclosure agreement or may be involved with land acquisition, and so you don't want your name associated with it. But for the most part, nest your name into a place so that it will not be easily eliminated. Because newspapers do not always give credit where credit is due. A little bit extra cast shadow of windows onto the glass. Just finishes this out. Gives that impression or illusion of depth, three-dimensionality of the window frame casting onto the glass. This is the most dangerous part of the process.
because it is very easy to overdo. It is very tempting to keep going. The important thing is to stop. Because it is extremely easy to overdo and go too far. But that is a very good place to stop right there. Okay, we have trace paper down over our isometric overlay. So in this view, the SketchUp model, perspective has been turned off and we have parallel projection and then the isometric or the ISO view. So this is a 30-30 isometric base layer that we printed out from SketchUp. We have a piece of trace over that. Working again from the sky looking back down, we need to start to add the first things that we would start to see. So this is our swale and floodplain down here. I'm just going to lay in a couple of topo lines just to remind ourselves that this is in fact declining from this street level down. And then start to look at maybe the first tree or a tree that might be growing up out of our bioswale. So I'll give that a shape or give it a circle. Give it something. We're looking down at this now, so our trees will be slightly different than they were in perspective. But I'm just going to give the general area of those two large mature trees at our bioswale down there. Maybe this is a bike lane trail or shared use path that runs off the page, so it's less defined. We can pick one of these two to make a crosswalk. Probably not both, but we need to select one of them because we do want to stop traffic going to the shared use path in the bioswale. So just pick one of these to create the crosswalk where folks will come from our little deli and then go across to the shared use path and or the bioswale with our floodplain. Kind of reinforce this line here. This is the sidewalk between parked cars and this commercial building. And then I will start to draw the box that the cars come in. Pop, 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 pop. Draw the box that they came in. Get a feel for that, you could put another box in one of the drive lanes. Why is this view so good for the public? Why is an isometric view so good for working with the public? A lot of people can't read plan. You show them a plan view, they're like, what? They have no concept of how buildings and open space relate to one another in plan. Some folks just can't read plan, but they can read isometric because they start to see the sides of things, right? They see the sides of buildings, they see cars in relationship to one another. They can relate to this type of drawing better. That's because a fraction of your public just cannot read plan view, cannot understand what plan view means, but they can react to this view, because this is how they played as children, right? With their cars and their Lincoln Logs and their Legos. This is sort of the view that you had playing with toys as children, so you can always relate to this. Isometric is also a very common view in gaming, because so many people play games in this isometric view. They're very used to this type of view as a gaming environment, so they can relate to it spatially as well. So particularly your generation, my generation, who've spent a lot of time playing video games, this isometric view is pretty natural for them. Okay. Little pyramid, cafe table,
People are basically just ants at this point. They're just little ellipses. A bit of a fence. Then I can start thinking about some more trees originating from either the front yard or from the greenway. There, there. Tree in the back behind our deli. Draw the trees just as we did before. Primary. From the trunk to primary, secondary, tertiary branches, up to its crown, or its canopy. Trunk, primary, secondary, tertiary branches. Grasses and shrubbery. We didn't really cover lighting. We may need some lighting. Kind of forgot the lighting in the last one. Whoops! Add our awnings, terraces. Cornices. Reminders of the architectural details that you decided in the previous phase. Extensions of the awning. Everything else you need is kind of there. Tree right here, but I'm going to make it very transparent. When we render this, we're going to decide how opaque the trees are because they're covering up, they could cover up a lot of information. So we want to be judicious about how much information we're going to cover. So we can make our trees very transparent looking. That will keep them visible as we go through the next iteration. Thank you.
start the recording. So we've added a layer of three cool gray on our asphalt. We've added buff or beige for our occupied areas, including all of the sidewalks, the beginnings of buildings, not the storefronts. And now we're adding yellow and goldenrod to our trees. Rotating the barrel as I work gives variety of marks and of color to our autumnal trees. But I'm keeping the focus of the drawing in the middle, so I'm stopping color over the whole subject and letting all of these trees fade into the white of the paint. Next color was desert tan. While spinning the barrel, I will continue a layer of pointed dots of color, kind of in the lower half of each tree's crown. I want the lighter colors on top and the darker shades lower to give the impression of depth and of roundedness. Continue to let these trees fade into the paper. And as these colors start to come together, I'm already getting the impression. I'm already tasting apple cider and donuts. I'm already starting to get those crisp fall leaves underfoot. And those cool breezes funneling down the stream bed. Flowing up into the streets here. I'll take my desert tan and I'll continue to warm. Just give the impression of maybe brick. Continue to warm up parts of the facade that might be brick. Continue to add more color. And just start to It's like a sliding scale of layers of color as we continue to add more impressions of depth. Maybe the grasses get a little bit of this as well, a little bit of this extra warmth. We wanted to start to create a pattern here in our intersection. We could start to do that. Slow traffic down as they approach this node in our development. Experiment with different patterns, Amish quilt patterns, checkerboard patterns, other ordering systems. Just what it does is creates a sense of arrival, a sense of place. Take my palm green and add some green near the bottom of these trees. Again, right in that part of fall where leaves are still turning, so there's still quite a bit of green leaf here in the first half of October, approaching mid-October, the Ides of October. Just use a little bit of pointillism with the toe of the marker. Continue to layer that in and if desired, I'll blend it. Some of my markers are brand new and they require a lot of blending. Some of my markers are starting to get old and they just kind of don't need all that extra blending. But when the markers are new, they expel quite a bit of liquid, and so it's necessary to pick up the excess and pick up or blend different layers together.
start identifying some gaps, but still letting these trees fade into the paper. Lower story windows still reflect the context. I'll grab my Cool Gray 6 for that. Car windows are dark, so I'll use the 6 gray for that. Just put in a layer of 6 gray in there. These lower story windows tend to reflect the context. Our reference image has some shadows in it, so I want to deal with those as well. I want to remember where the cast shadows are. Those get a little bit darker. I might use the pencil sign pen for that. Cast shadows from awnings and decks, window frames, cornices. Just get some darkness. And it all kind of comes together nicely. Starts to look real once you get those shadows and those lines together. When the lines are really loose, it starts to give an impression of realness from this aerial view. Darkness under trees, castings, cast shadows from awnings onto glass, window frames onto glass. Cars onto the pavement. Blueberry. Put in blueberry at the bottom of the tree. This represents the texture of the tree, casting shadow onto its lower boughs. Blueberry casting the shadow of the tree onto the ground. It blends with the green. It's an old watercolor trick. Because green contains yellow, you can use purple to darken it. Because brown contains yellow, you can use purple to darken it. So consequently, we can use this blueberry to cast shadows from trees onto this pavement, so it's a little frightening at first, but it really does give an illusion of depth and three-dimensionality. We can cast shadows from our awnings and our windows, cafe tables, onto the pavement as well. We can also add a little bit of blueberry to darken this whole facade. You can actually layer it on top of your previous colors and it will work to give that whole side a little bit of darkness. You can help darken alleys, things like that. It's an old watercolor trick. Because purple is the color complement of yellow, so many of our earth tones contain yellow, whether they be plants, greens, or brick, or stone colors contain so much yellow. Thank you. Now, we take some colored pencils and we finish out our building materials, awnings, cars. We can layer it right on top of the desert tan and on top of that blueberry. We selected a green awning for our deli. They have additional primary colors, awnings, building details. You may have additional thinking behind crosswalk colors. This is a Tuscan red. You could use a burnt sienna, terracotta, or zebra crossings. You may want to express your bike lane, a shared use path with a stained asphalt or stained concrete. Maybe more readable with a green. There may be additional softer colors for upper story windows or car colors, things like that. Kind of a late in the season for flowers, but there may be still some texture and color in those flower beds, or it might be the brown of the grasses or the perennials as they get as they're ready to be cut. Again, we'll hide our signature and nest our signature in a place where it can't. Preferably on the front, nest our signature into an area where it can't be ignored. Okay. So we build up a color, a buildup of waxy color, a buildup of petroleum-based marker color. When we flip it back over, all of our lines are crisp and have full integrity. Okay. The logic behind this is that as the color builds up on the back, it doesn't smear or cover up any of our good line work on the front.